This interview is for information only and should not be considered as investment advice or a recommendation to buy shares in the company featured. Welcome to this Stockbox interview.
Joining us today is, of course, George Roach, the CEO of Premier African Minerals. George, thank you for your time. How are you?
Thank you very much. I'm fine, Mark, and nice to chat to you.
Yes, indeed. Well, of course, you've had your interims out, and that included the sort of lengthy and detailed statement from yourself there. So I just want to pick up on a few points from that statement. So, I mean, first of all, you say you're consistently able to produce at grade and at target recoveries at both your on-site laboratory and in independent test work. And at this time, the mica recovery section is fully operational. However, the spodumene section, not so. And the OEM, the original equipment manufactured there for the float plant, has provided different parameters for the operation of the spodumene section and has identified a significant difference between laboratory test work and plant operating protocols that see a substantially reduced residue time in laboratory work as opposed to the operation of the cleaner cells in the plant. And you're following a multi-option approach on how best to move forward with Zulu, including possible sale in its entirety, a joint venture, or the potential installation of an additional spodumene float section to continue the operations here. So from reading that, it sort of reads to me that you can get the recoveries in the lab, but you can't get it at scale in the float section due to a fundamental design flaw, and you've got effectively different options on the table. Is that sort of right in for the crux of it?
Not entirely, Mark. Let me just pick up on a couple of things that you've said there. In terms of the spodumene float plant, the residence time that the spodumene material is spending in the cleaner cells appears to be excessive. In other words, it's almost as though they're too big for the material that's flowing through. Now, I'd much rather have something that was too big than too small, because I think it's going to be a lot easier to remedy. And there are some procedural suggestions that I think will be put into play that could perhaps improve that quite quickly. But there's work to be done there. I think that the very important issue that stands out is that the last item in the circuit that we need to deal with is now the spodumene float recovery and the cleaner stages. Everything up to that is now fine, working, and in fact, we've got a lot more capacity in the front end leading up to that than we had before.
Right. Okay. So it's the cleaner cells you think is the the Enprontec are telling you is the main problem. You can get the grades in the lab. You can't get them in the float section because of oversized cleaner cells.
That appears to be what it is at the moment.
Okay.
Now, what is of course very interesting is that in Zimbabwe we've done a lot of other test work, and our material has been floated successfully and at grade using other different float cell technology. And I'm not in any way suggesting that what we have is not appropriate. What we have is advanced technology that should be working very, very well. But the comparables that have been done is really on very basic and simple float cell design. And the recoveries are good. Okay. We get the grade, we get the recoveries and so on using alternatives at the moment.
Okay. And I mean, we can talk about the reasons as to why this wasn't designed correctly, but there's perhaps not so much point in going back and looking at the past. It perhaps is what it is, but it has happened and that's the situation. You also mentioned in the statement there that you're engaged with the Chinese firm that has built flotation plants that are currently operating within Zimbabwe, producing similar ore to what you're getting at Zulu, and one is indeed available, but you would need to fund the purchase price and, of course, the integration to the site, estimated at around $400,000. So, I mean, yeah, what's your sort of comment on here? Can you remedy what you've got at the moment by changing the cleaner cells, or are you actually looking at getting a new plant put in?
I think that there's an opportunity for both and a logical reason for both.
Okay.
Bear in mind that the front end of the Zulu plant is now able to produce through the comminution circuit much more material at size than was originally estimated. So there's an excess of capacity in the milling circuit. Now, it's likely that the microcircuit can pick up the excess, but the spodumene plant, as it is at the moment, could not. So we have a situation where we could bring in at relatively low cost and relatively short time this additional spodumene float plant, allow the OEM in the background to resolve and fix whatever it is on the existing spodumene float plant, and in a relatively short period of time and at relatively low cost, to have accommodated the additional capacity that we've created through the bigger mill and so on, and to put us in a position where we can produce at a significantly higher tonnage than was originally designed. So that's the opportunity as I see it at the moment.
Right. Okay. So there's that opportunity there. And of course, then there's the other opportunity you talk about with potentially a complete sale or indeed a joint venture. I mean, what's the preferred option?
To be candid, the one that's best for Prem and for our shareholders at the end of the day. But I think that what may make most sense is some form of joint venture with Zulu. We've brought Zulu a long way. There's a big investment there. There's a big opportunity for somebody to come in and be a partner with us and work with us. There's a tremendous amount of knowledge being accumulated, a lot of development work done, and it's a logical thing to be able to do. So that's one option. The essence of this is that if Prem is to continue as the sole owner and operator of this, it needs funding. Yeah. And in that instance, we're being very candid. That's what we need to do. If the funding is not going to be available, we need to explore the alternative opportunities. The alternatives are a sale, a joint venture, something similar along those lines.
Right. Okay. And that option will effectively be put to shareholders to make that call when the time is right?
Ultimately, it will be a shareholder decision. Obviously, the management would look at it and recommend very carefully. But to the extent that there may be a disposition of a significant asset, yes, this must go to shareholders.
Yeah. Okay.
I think that shareholders need to take a very careful view of whether that's the right way to go, as opposed to having got to the point we've got to now with the knowledge we've accumulated, the development, the capital expended, as to whether or not that's correct to do a disposal or to actually take this final step ourselves.
Yeah, okay. So I can see all the options there. I mean, at what point is a further announcement made to make a recommendation on the options? I mean, you maybe can't disclose, but are discussions going on in the background with potential sales or joint venture partners?
Yes, Mark, there are. There's significant discussions going on in the background. I unfortunately can't disclose more than that. But I think that at a point in time in the pretty near future, there we should be in a position to have better disclosure. All right, and to be able to put a formal proposal to shareholders. Right. In the interim, I think it would be remiss of the company not to be frank about where we are, which we're trying to do, and not to say to shareholders that we do need to have a backstop. I don't particularly want to go down a line of huge additional dilution or whatever it may be. But at the end of the day, if nothing comes of the others and we have not put ourselves in a position where we do have a backstop, right? We then really do have a bigger problem. So really, I'm trying to be as pragmatic and as frank as we can be at the moment.
Okay, so that's where the disapplication of preemption rights comes in then, that backstop to put you in more of a stronger position with negotiations and also options on the table.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Okay. Okay, okay. And I mean, yeah, I'm sure shareholders won't be too pleased to see the disapplication preemption rights. I know you said, in last time we spoke, actually, you said you would be, you don't want to see any more dilution. You said that yourself. You really don't want to see any more dilution. You also said you wanted to demonstrably show that this thing is resolved and it works before running or pursuing other options. So, I mean, you will have to effectively, I think, convince shareholders either through options on the table or that it is worth parting with more money to effectively go it yourself with the additional float plants. So, I mean, yeah, how do you plan to sort of convince the shareholders of either options?
Well, Mark, you're, first of all, you're entirely right in your summation of it. But in terms of is spodumene produced from the ore body at Zulu using whatever float plant there is, that's demonstrable. If we are to look at this alternative equipment from the other Chinese OEM, there is identical plant operating in Zimbabwe right now, producing. And some of our ore has been run through under there. Their engineers have taken some of our ore and done test work on it. So demonstrably, that functions.
Right. I
remain confident that our existing OEM is in fact going to come up with procedures and whatever it is that's necessary to demonstrate that the more high-tech float plant that we have is going to do exactly what it's supposed to do.
Okay. And you're working closely with the OEM there. I mean, is there any sort of recourse there for past promises, or is it a matter of just getting it sorted?
No, I think we need to bear in mind that our OEM on the float plant, in fact, was never an original OEM to us. They were instructed by Stark as to what to provide.
Okay.
We're never asked to do the sizing. I don't think that one can have any comment in regard to our existing OEM other than to say that they have gone out of their way to help and do whatever they can to get this thing right.
Okay.
And I believe that they will.
Right. Okay. So just to sum up in terms of options then, the OEM's working on the current cleaner cells to mitigate the issues there, to get the current section working, which you'll hopefully be able to announce updates on going forward. And then, of course, there's the bigger picture of what goes on corporately, sale, joint venture, or indeed disapplication of preemption rights for the other plant to be put in place. Yep. Have I got that right?
You got it right.
Right, okay. And if you could demonstrably show investors that which option is best and how, I think that would go down well, because I don't I think people will be reluctant to part with more money unless they're really convinced that that it's going to work. I'm sure you'll agree on that.
I completely agree on that. Completely. I mean, Mark, the other point that I've made, and I think I've made it in my comments in the interims, is that we really were only able to start trying to properly optimize and get this float plant working after Q1 this year. It was only when the comminution circuit was finished that we were then able to move into this part of it. I understand it's late, but we lost a year before we could even start trying to put it right because of the milling and comminution problems that we'd had before. So I think that the progress that we've made on the float side has actually been quite good. And, you know, I remain confident that especially with all the diverse test work that has been done in so many different places, so many different reagents now, that it works. The ore body is perfectly capable of delivering what we need to deliver.
Okay. So just in terms of the sort of the next big moment, if you like, that shareholders can look out for, what can you sort of present to them? We're waiting for news on the corporate side. Are you going to sort of make a case as to if the general meeting is coming up?
I think the news on the corporate side is probably going to be first. Okay. I hope so. I hope that that's how it's going to be. I'd much rather have that through before we start actually having to deal with general meetings.
Sure.
It'll make it much easier.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, good. Well, thank you. Thank you very much, George. The only final question I'll just slot in now, because people have been asking it for quite a while, is the appointment of Graham Hill. Just, what sort of attracted him to the role, what role he might play, etc. People are quite interested in this gentleman.
Yeah, Graham's technically a very competent engineer, and I particularly want to work with him. I think that the this late stage issues of a little bit more, as we've been discussing in regard to Zulu, has delayed that. But at the end of the day, Prem's much more than just Zulu. There's still the Otjozondo, RHA, and others. And Graham has the technical competencies to pull those things together very, very quickly.
Okay.
So I believe there's a future there, yes.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, George Roach, CEO of Premier African Minerals, and hopefully it won't be too long before we're discussing some of the other options available to you that we can talk about with shareholders.
Indeed. Thank you, Mark.
If you enjoyed this interview, then give us a thumbs up, a like, or a retweet. Subscribe to us on YouTube or follow us on Twitter, and hit that notification bell to be the first to know when we release new content. There's loads of great content on our website too, across all our programs at stockboxmedia.com. Thank you for watching.